Hello dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Rimalpreet Kaur, Assistant Professor, Khalsa College of Education, Ranjit Avenue, Amritsar. Well students, today we will discuss about the topic Assessment and Evaluation at School Level. After studying this topic, you will be able to define and explain the term assessment, define and explain the term evaluation, differentiate between assessment and evaluation, discuss the purpose of assessment and evaluation. In Indian education system, the terms assessment and evaluation are associated with examination. Assessment is an essential and inseparable component of the teaching-learning process. In the assessment process, test results are subject to critical study according to established measurement principles. Testing is a part of assessment, and it is true that assessment encompasses much more than testing. Appropriate test results ensures that students are progressing towards achievement. Recent federal legislation now requires the classroom teacher's involvement in the instruction and regular assessment of the performance and progress of special education. The main focus of testing for decision making is to use tests and other measuring procedures which are technically adequate. The dimensions of the test are selected according to the skill to be evaluated and administered and scored later to make decision about a pupil, whereas the function of assessment is to collect information regarding tests and about other measuring instruments. This information should be critically evaluated and integrated in relevant context. The critical analysis of test results and other information helps in making a decision about a pupil. First of all, let's understand what is assessment. The term assessment should be reserved for application to individual as far as possible. It covers activities included in grading, that is formal and informal, examining, certifying and so on. For example, students' achievement on a particular course may be assessed, an applicant's attitude for a particular job may be assessed, a teacher's competence may be assessed. The word assesses originates from the Latin word assedire, means to sit by, so assessment is a human activity which involves interaction aimed at seeking to understand what learners have achieved. It may be informal or informal ways, and it may be descriptive or judgmental in nature. The main aim of assessment is to improve the student's learning and development. To provide grade or marks for students' performance is not the aim of assessment. Similarly, to judge the quality of the student's achievement, teacher needs to know, to collect, to analyze, and to interpret the performance of various activities of the students. This assessment is used to understand the extent and nature of learning that has taken place in different domains. On the basis of the above explanation, Rountree in 1977 has defined assessment as: assessment in education can be thought of as occurring whenever one person in some kind of interaction, direct or indirect with another, is conscious of obtaining and interpreting information about the knowledge and understanding or abilities and attitudes of that other person. To some extent or other, it is an attempt to know that person. Erwin, Brown and Knight in 1974 defined assessment is a systematic basis for making inferences about the learning and development of students. The process of defining, selecting, designing, collecting, analyzing, interpreting and using information to increase students' learning and development. Now, next important thing is to understand the term evaluation. It is very often the term assessment is used interchangeably with the word evaluation and have an impression of similar meaning. Scriven has pointed out in an important article in 1967 that evaluation usually involves making comparison to other programs, curricula or organizational schemes. Thorpe stated evaluation is not synonymous with assessment because evaluation is the procedure of assigning value to the learning outcomes during and at the end of a course. Assessment focuses on the learning of students, and the results may be used as a source of information for evaluation. So these two terms have different meanings in the context of educational practice. On the basis of this meaning of evaluation, we can now draw the definition of evaluation. The most extended definition of evaluation has been given by CEB in 1977, who described evaluation as the systematic collection and interpretation of evidence leading as a part of the process to a judgment of a value with a view to action. Similarly, Ehrenbach in 1980 defined it: by the term evaluation, we mean systematic examination of events occurring in and consequent on a contemporary program, an examination conducted to assist in improving this program and other programs having the same general purpose. From the above reading, let us try to find out the main key elements of the definitions related to assessment and evaluation. In assessment work, words like examining, grading, certifying are used very frequently. In the educational setup, most of the institutions find it appropriate to keep the records of the students' achievement by providing them with a number, a letter code, or a comments such as satisfactory or a need improvement. This again depends upon critical evaluation and integrated information such as decision about pupil to assign a grade, recommend for an advanced program, about instructional repeat, review, etc. From the definitions of evaluation, we can very easily draw the main elements of evaluation, like systematic examination of events, systematic collection of evidences and information, analysis of information and judging effectiveness. Here, systematic collection of information or evidence means information gathered through the use of standardized tests, observation, questionnaires, and interview. In short, we can say that whatever information gathered in whatever way should be acquired in a systematic way, including any kind of prior information. Here, analysis and interpretation means a critical consideration of evidence. Effectiveness of judgment is based upon effective collection and analysis. So, evaluation is a process of inquiry-based learning based on certain criteria like use of more than one technique. It helps in planning and directing desired modifications and reflecting the correct state of techniques and research methods. Now let's discuss what is the distinction between assessment and evaluation. Since a long time, it has been observed that there are two words used interchangeably in the field of educational evaluation. Having different meanings, they are not synonymous. If education is meant for the preparation of meaningful life, then assessment should be a way of providing feedback on knowledge, skills, attitudes, and work products for the purpose of elevating future performances and better learning outcomes. Both have their own purpose and, when used properly, can show better results to teaching and learning. Assessment used to look at how the level of quality of a performance or outcome could be improved in future by providing some judgment, whereas evaluation is used to describe the determination of the level of quality. It focuses only on the actual level of quality with no interest in why that level has attained. To get a better performance or outcome, both are used for different reasons, having specific criteria to observe the performance. They do have some similar steps to follow for data collection, observation, and to prepare a concluding draft or report. In both the cases, persons required to observe, to evaluate, to perform, and to provide feedback as an assessor or an evaluator. The work of evaluator is to observe and to find out the strongest and weakest point of the student and suggest ways how one can improve his performance in future, whereas the work of assessor is to make judgment or to determine the level of quality. Assessment and evaluation are not synonymous, they differ in different dimensions. Now let us see what is the actual difference between assessment and evaluation through this table. Here, assessment focuses on the learning of the student, whereas evaluation focuses on the way the various components of a course perform. Assessment provides feedback on knowledge, skills, attitudes, and work products for the purpose of better future performance, whereas evaluation determines the level of quality of a performance or outcomes and enables decision-making based on the level of quality demonstrated. If we talk about assessment from the timing point of view, it is formative, means ongoing process to improve learning, and evaluation from the timing point of view is summative, means conducted at the end of the session. The focus of measurement in assessment is process-oriented, that is how learning is going on. Whereas in evaluation, the focus of measurement is product-oriented, that is what has been learned. In assessment, it is reflected in nature, means internally defined criteria. In evaluation, it is prescriptive in nature, means follow the externally imposed standards. Findings of assessment is diagnostic and to identify areas for improvement. Findings of evaluation is judgmental and to arrive at an overall grade. If we talk about assessment, standards of measurement is absolute, that is, it strives for ideal outcome. If we talk about evaluation, standards of measurement is comparative, that is, it derives better from worse. Assessment results may be used as a source of information for evaluation. Evaluation results on direct bearing on students' assessment. Now let's discuss various ways of assessment and evaluation. There are innumerable methods and techniques of assessing and evaluating a learner. First is pre-tests, post-tests. Pre-tests are given to determine what learners already know with regard to the objectives at hand. With a pre-test, an instructor can determine what the students need to learn and then help the students focus on the pieces of instruction that have not previously been learned. A pre-test might be given before a lesson starts or as a way to gain students' attention and provide them with objectives of the lesson. Post-tests are usually given towards the end of the lesson. Post-tests will assess whether the learner can achieve both the enabling objectives and terminal objectives of a lesson by testing enabling as well as terminal objectives. The teacher has more information as to where learning has gone wrong. Another is performance assessment. According to NITCO, a performance assessment presents a hands-on task to a student and uses clearly defined criteria to evaluate how well the student achieved the application specified by the learning target. During a performance assessment, students must apply their knowledge and skills from multiple areas to show they can perform a learning target. A performance assessment may require a student to make something, produce a report, give a demonstration. Unlike short answer or multiple choice items used in other types of assessments that require indirect demonstration, performance task require direct demonstration of achievement of a learning target. Next is peer or self-evaluation assessment strategies. Peer and self-evaluation assessment strategies ask students to reflect on, make a judgment about, and then report on their own or a peer's behavior and performance. Both performance and attitude can be evaluated with the peer and self-assessments. Assessment tools for this type of evaluation might include sentence completion, Likert scales, checklists, or holistic scales. Then there is portfolio assessment. According to NITCO, a portfolio is a limited collection of a student's work that is used either to present the student's best works or demonstrate the student's educational growth over a given time span. A portfolio is a collection limited only to a work that best serves the portfolio's purpose rather than a collection of all of a student's work. The pieces contained in a portfolio are carefully and deliberately selected. Then comes norm reference tests. According to SEAL and Glasgow, a person's score on norm reference test shows where the person stands relative to other people who have taken the test. The Scholastic Aptitude Test is an example of a NRT because it shows how a person stands relative to other potential college students. Success is measured by how far ahead a person is of the other test takers. NRTs are usually used for selection purposes. NRTs are designed to measure relative standing in a group rather than mastery of a specific skill. Another is Criterion Reference Test. Criterion reference tests are also referred to as content reference or objective reference test. According to Seals and Gasco, a test is criterion referenced when its score can be translated into a statement about what a person has learned relative to a standard. A CRT score provides information about a person's mastery of a behavior relative to the objective and reflects that person's mastery of one specific skill. Typically, a cutoff score is set and those who meet or exceed the score pass the test. Any number of test takers can pass a CRT. Then comes achievement test. Achievement test assesses the knowledge, abilities, skills that are at the center of direct instruction in schools. Achievement test may be standardized or non-standardized. Standardized tests are created by professional agencies and use the same materials and administration procedure for all students. Non-standardized test does not contain the assessment materials tried out by a publisher, nor any student-based data being collected concerning how well the test is functioning. Another technique is observation. It is usually used to make an informal assessment of student behavior, attitudes, skills, concepts, or processes. Observations may be recorded through anecdotal notes, checklists, video, audio recordings, or photos. Observations may be used to collect data about behaviors that are difficult to evaluate by other methods. Sometimes learners are assessed in on-the-job situations. According to Smith and Regan, probably the best way to see if students have learned what we want them to learn at the necessary level is to take them into the real world and have them perform what they have been instructed to do. Then comes rating scales and checklists, which can be used to record the quality of the process as the worker performs. Another way is conducting interviews. Interviews are used to get a better idea of students' attitudes, thinking processes, level of understanding, ability to make connections, or ability to communicate or apply concepts. Interviewing consists of observing and questioning the students. Interviews can be both formal and informal and are a good tool for diagnosing students' strengths as well as needs. Then comes simulations. In addition to being an instructional strategy, simulations are also useful for assessment purposes, especially for assessing higher order rule learning and attitude change. Simulations can be delivered using print-based or interactive multimedia tools. A case study is an example of a print-based simulation. Case studies are often used to assess in fields such as management, law, and medicine. The use of personal computer is a common way to administer an interactive multimedia simulation assessment. By using computers, simulations can easily be administered to an individual or a group. Some of the more elaborate examples of simulation testing using multimedia include pilot and astronaut training. Another technique is writing essays. According to NITCO, essays are usually used as an assessment tool in two general situations. First is in subject areas like social studies, mathematics, science, or history to evaluate how well students can explain, communicate, compare, contrast, analyze, synthesize, evaluate, otherwise express their thinking about several aspects of the subject. The second is to evaluate students in their ability to write in standard English with appropriate use of language and to write for various purposes including exposition, persuasion, and communication. There are two basic varieties of essay items, restricted and extended response. Restricted response items limit what the student is allowed to answer in both connect and form, whereas extended response items give students the freedom to express their own ideas and organize those ideas in their own way. To help eliminate subjectivity in the evaluation of essay items, designers usually develop checklists, rating scales, model answers, or use multiple grader to evaluate the exam. Other technique is using recall item. These are used to assess declarative knowledge objectives. In response to recall items, students are asked to reproduce what they were presented with during instruction. Recall items are usually in a written format, such as short answer, fill in the blank, or completion items. While these types of test items require a lot of memory, they also require fewer, higher reasoning processes. Then comes recognition items. In response to recognition items, learners are required to recognize or identify the correct answer from a group of alternatives. Declarative knowledge that has been memorized can be assessed with recognition items. Multiple choice, matching, and true-false items can also be used as recognition items. These types of questions can be constructed in such a way as to require the use of higher cognitive skills. Learners may be asked to apply learned principles or concepts in order to recognize a correct answer. Another way to assess is through constructed answer items. With constructed answer items, learners are required to produce or construct a response. Responses may take a written or performance-based format. Constructed answer items require a higher reasoning of intellectual skills than recall items and demand more memory and cognitive strategies than recognition items because the students are less cued and the options are less limited. Additionally, constructed answer items often are more closely aligned with real-life situations and are usually a more valid assessment. Then comes formative assessment. It helps the instructor to monitor a student's learning while in progress. Formative assessments are usually less formal than summative assessments, and although the instructor may keep a record of the results, they are not used to report official achievement progress such as a letter grade. Formative assessments may help diagnose individual students' learning needs and help to plan instruction accordingly. Last but not the least, there is summative assessment. It is used to evaluate students as well as the instructor after one or more unit is taught. Results from summative assessment are usually used to count toward a final grade. Summative assessments are useful tools for reporting students' progress to parents, school authorities, managers, etc. Now let's understand the purpose of assessment and evaluation. Assessment has many purposes related to teaching learning process. The purpose of assessment is necessarily to improve the teaching learning process and materials. It helps to review the objectives that have been identified for different school stages by guiding the extent to which capabilities of the learners have been developed. This purpose of the assessment is the selection of students for a general, professional, and technical course, then stimulate students for learning in different way by providing them informative feedback and suggesting practices. The purpose behind this work is to help in certifying the students that whether they have achieved the target of a particular level of performance or not. Its purpose is also to review the effectiveness of the teaching arrangements. In this regard, Rowntree, Freeman, and Lewis have identified a number of purposes of assessment, such as improving teaching and learning, maintenance of standards of the students, and accreditation. A well-designed assessment helps to motivate the learners to learn without threat and stress. Its purpose is to identify the group of children who are very slow, bright, and problematic, and the group who need remedial action without waiting for any formal assessment. To diagnose learning difficulties and problem areas, certain evaluations and formal testings can be applied. Credible assessment provides a regular report card or certificates to the learners after the completion of a course with certain feedback. Finally, the purpose of evaluation is to prove that something has happened as a result of training and learning. It improves or ensures that the activities and future programs would be much better than the present one. So, in order to conclude, we can say that assessment and evaluation both are concerned with the preparation for a meaningful life and should be a way of providing credible feedback regarding learner. Thank you.